Thanks so much, Mike, for joining us today.
Michelle, it's great to talk to you. And for Anson, we got the old Sparty coffee cup this morning, too.
Look at that.
Go green. Michelle, you know with Mike Emrick, I know him as Doc.
I have to say the official, you know, Mike Emrick, but it is everyone fondly refers to you as Doc Emrick. So if you're okay with that, we'll go with that going forward.
The last time I was pulled over by a state trooper in Ohio, it was Michael R.
How is life for you in your home studio bubble? You're calling games remotely. I know that you've done that before, but it's a little different. You don't have your partner next to you. You know, you're kind of relying on cues via a monitor. What's this adjustment been like for you?
It has been different, Michelle, but I think the one thing too is that were I in the arena, the one thing that I miss the most, and Anson can probably appreciate this too, is being able to be right next to the players in the dressing room and getting stories, personal stories, which we can't do anyway. You don't get personal time with the coaches that much either. It's all in mass. And so that part, which I think is the most important part, because we can learn a lot that we can share that is not necessarily statistical, but stories, we're not getting the opportunity to do that anyway. But to be in a studio, there are two things that are upsides that I learned right away. During the intermission, Michelle and Ace, there is no lineup at the concession stand, and there's no lineup at the necessary. So you don't have to wait very long to get a soda or to visit the bathroom.
But the good thing is, Doc, watching the broadcast, you can't tell. I talked to my parents back in Toronto. They always ask me, like, where is everyone calling these games from? Because they can't tell where everyone is, and it seems pretty seamless. So you guys have been doing a terrific job doing that. I've been pumping my tires a little bit after the Bruins scored their overtime winning goal. I was the last Bruin player to do it, multiple overtime games against the Hurricanes. What would be your most memorable OT game that you witnessed?
Oh, gee. I've been very lucky to watch a lot of overtime games and get to deliver them. I suppose just because of the one that we had that was five overtimes earlier, it would have been either of two. I've had the pleasure of doing two overtime games. One was Marty Brodeur against Dominic Hasek. It was a sixth game between New Jersey and Buffalo at the Old Odd in Buffalo. You're too young to have played there, right?
Nope, but I watched those games on TV, Hockey Night in Canada.
Okay. There were 120 shots that night in four overtimes, and Dave Hannon from the right circle was the last shot of the night that got past Brodeur. And so there was going to be a seventh game. And Dale Howard-Chuck had a great chance in the last seconds of the seventh game, and Marty was able to shut that down, and the Devils won that seventh game and went on. That was in 94. The other one was the one that came to a lot of people's attention because Kelly Rudy was in that game and set the NHL record for saves that was just broken this past week. And so that one was Pat LaFontaine's goal on the night before Easter and Easter Sunday morning. We even did a countdown that night. Bill Clement and I were doing the game on ESPN. We did a countdown to midnight, like you would do on New Year's Eve, to ring in Easter Sunday. Funny what you remember, it was in 1987, and it was a seventh game between Washington and the New York Islanders. There was, I'm not plugging my book, but I guess I am, that's coming out in the fall, and there's a chapter devoted to that, and we've talked to several people, Kevin Allen, who co-wrote it with me, about that night, and there was a wedding that went on that night in the D.C. area. Islander fans attended the wedding. They came to the first part of the game, and then they went to the wedding and attended the reception. They got out of the reception late and turned on the radio to see how the game turned out. Well, the game was still on. And at that time, you didn't scan tickets. You had stubs. They tore the ticket in half. They still had the stubs. So they went back to the arena and got to watch the rest of the game. And the reason that I knew about it was they were in their tuxedos and they were down near the Islanders bus when the players got got on the bus to go back home. So anyhow, those are memories that I have, and aren't you sorry you asked?
No, not at all. What's the name of your book, Doc?
It's called Off Mic, and anyone who buys a copy of the book when it comes out in the fall, any author proceeds go directly to the hands-on care of animals. My wife and I are committed to veterinary care of animals, and so it's a non-profit book as far as we're concerned. But it chronicles my time in hockey, but also with lots of stories, both from the NHL. It's even though I worked a long time for the Devils and the Flyers, it's not a Flyers book. It's not a Devils book. It's just about life in hockey, and also a little bit about baseball, because I got a chance to do some baseball one night. And so that gets its own chapter too.
Fantastic. We'll look forward to reading that. Real quick, I want to ask you, you know, you're a historian yourself. I'm curious, how do you think this year's unique Stanley Cup and the challenges that it presented, you know, leading up, getting back into the play-in, and just what we've seen unfold, where do you think this will stand in history, you know, winning this thing among all of the Stanley Cups prior?
Well, all the way back through history, we've had a great tribute paid to the athletes who play this sport. And I don't think all we are going to have is another tribute paid to the athletes who play this sport, unless we get a real surprise. And I don't think we will. It will be a tribute to the athletes who had 4.5 months off, came back, even on their own. And I emphasize that because of other stories that we've heard, even on their own, had 100% perfect tests. And now have had, I guess the total over the last 3 weeks would be 18,000 and change perfect tests, have come back and battled hard, and even into 5 overtimes and multiple overtimes by Boston, eclipsing Anson Carter's record. All of these things that have happened, I think, is a wonderful tribute to the athletes, because as Anson can tell you, even though they are professionals, and this is rarely talked about, this is a time of year when they aren't paid large amounts of money for competing for the Stanley Cup. My favorite story was told by John Davidson, who I believe has something to do with Madison Square Garden these days. So John and I are working for Fox, and we are on a pre-Stanley Cup final conference call. And we are talking about that very subject, that you are competing to have your name on the Stanley Cup. You don't really think about the fact that there actually is some money involved. John said, in 1979, I'm playing for the Rangers. We get to the Stanley Cup final against Montreal. We lose in 5 games. I'm at home. And after a couple of weeks' time, you know, summer is underway. And I go through the mail. And there's a letter from the National Hockey League. And, oh, gee, I wonder what that is. I open the letter up, and it's my playoff share. It's a check. He said, I forgot we got paid. And that tells you what this is about. So in answer to your question, this is just one more further tribute to the athletes who play this sport and the quality of games that we have gotten already since August the 1st.